Hi, I'm Emma, and I'm going to talk to you about pine martens and squirrels. So there's a lot to cover in a very short time. I'm going to talk to you a little bit about me at first, and then a little bit about European pine martens, a little bit about red and grey squirrels and their ecology. Look at the published research on pine martens and squirrels to date. A look at pine marten distribution in the rest of mainland Britain and plans for the future there, and then a look at the future for pine martens in Scotland, question mark, and a sustainable future for red squirrels. So a little bit about me. I started researching squirrels back in 2008, perhaps, looking at the feeding ecology of a translocated population of red squirrels with Colin Lawton for my honours degree. I then went on to do a PhD with Colin on the role of the pine marten in Irish squirrel population dynamics. I then went on to do postdoctoral studies on pine martens and squirrels in Scotland. And I'm currently the conservation officer with Saving Scotland's Red Squirrels, which is a Scottish Wildlife Trust project. And our goal is to eradicate the population of urban grey squirrels in Aberdeen in the northeast of Scotland. So a little bit about pine martens. They are an elusive member of the mustelid family, very closely associated with trees. They have semi-retractile claws, this makes them very agile climbers. They use trees as den sites, cavities in trees, as refuge, and occasionally hunting, for example, in spring and summer when they prey upon birds' nests and squirrel drays. And they also den in crevices, root systems, outhouses, and other things as well. So they're not totally reliant on trees at all. They have an omnivorous diet. They eat a lot of small mammals. So in Scotland, their preferred small mammal is the vole, and in Ireland, it's actually the woodmouse. They eat fruit and nuts, invertebrates, birds, reptiles, amphibians, and whatever is locally available and abundant. They have a difference between male and females. Males generally larger than females, and the average adult weight is between 1.1 and 2 kilos. So they live at low densities, and even when we talk about high densities later on in this, it still is going to be relatively low because of their ecology. So we'll take a look at natural ranges. First of all, we have the natural range of the European pine marten in Europe here, and then beneath it we have the natural range of the Eurasian red squirrel. So you can see very clearly that these species have lived alongside each other for a very, very, very long time. On the right-hand side now, on the top, you can see the natural species range of the American fisher. In the middle, the American marten, and at the very bottom, the eastern grey squirrel, which we know as the American grey squirrel. So you can see that even in its native range, the grey squirrel doesn't overlap with their natural range doesn't overlap with any similar species, even to the European pine marten, a tree-climbing mammalian predator. This is relevant. So a little bit about squirrels now. We have the red squirrel body mass around 200 to 300 grams, grey squirrel body mass around 500 to 800 grams, so around 250% heavier than red squirrels. And this will obviously be important if you're trying to escape from a predator in terms of how far in the tree, how far you can go out along the small thin branch extremities. And also how your access to refuge, the sizes of the holes that you can get into. And interestingly, the zygomatic arch in grey squirrels, so the width of their head basically, is around 25% bigger than red squirrels too. So grey squirrels, because of their bigger size, this has helped them outcompete red squirrels. But now that their native predator is back on the scene, it's actually their size and width is actually something that's working against them. Red squirrels also live in densities of around 0.3 per hectare, depending on the habitat, which is quite a bit lower than average grey squirrel densities, which are around 1 per hectare. So this is a really whistle-stop tour of the published research to date. There's been loads and loads of research in the last like 10, 15 years. I'm going to give you the headlines of those very, very briefly. There's obviously a lot more nuances to them. If anyone wants more information on any of the studies, I'm going to put my email address up on the very last slide, so you can just email me and I'll send you the PDFs of the papers. So the first study that talked about pine martens and squirrels was actually in 2007, the Irish Squirrel Survey, where you can see the on the right, it's the two big holes in grey squirrel distribution there, and that were starting to appear. And anecdotally, this was being put down to the recovery of the pine marten population locally. Then the next study to be published was in 2013. That was the first study out of my PhD, and it was on pine marten diet and abundance, and actually was the first published evidence of pine marten spraying on grey squirrels. And it found, it was a small sample size, but it found that grey squirrels were preyed on at a much higher frequency than red squirrels. And interestingly, the same finding was replicated later on by a sample, a study with a bigger sample size in Northern Ireland, which is really great. In 2014, there was a population crash in grey squirrels, and this was the main, oops, the main paper out of my PhD. You saw it for a flash there. So basically, we found that grey squirrels had crashed in around 9,000 kilometers square of their former range, and red squirrels were in competitive release in this area in what would typically be considered exceptional grey squirrel habitat. And this was correlated to pine marten presence. Obviously, at that stage, we couldn't say anything about causation, but certainly there was a really strong correlation. In 2015, there was the Irish Squirrel Survey. It was with the 2012 data from Colin Lawton's research group again in Ireland. And you can see on the left, the grey squirrel range has declined even a little bit further. Red squirrels widespread throughout the country, except for maybe the likes of County Meath and maybe some of Northern Ireland and in the west, where there's a lack of well-connected suitable habitat. And pine martens in blue, they're recovering really well throughout all of Ireland. Then we have in 2016 another study from the same research group, which found that the grey squirrel decline was larger than first thought. In 2018, my study in Scotland found that in Scotland, pine martens do suppress grey squirrel populations as well. So I'll try to briefly explain this figure for you. So on the x-axis on the bottom, pine marten connectivity could be better explained or described as exposure to pine martens. And on the y-axis, we have on the left grey squirrel occupancy or probability of occupancy. So one means you're definitely going to find grey squirrels there, and zero means you're extremely unlikely to find grey squirrels there. And on then the right-hand side is the same for red squirrels. The different colours are the different areas. So in red, we have the Scottish Highlands, in green, the central Scotland, and in blue, the borders. So it was a short-term study, as most PhD or postdoctoral studies are. We didn't have the luxury of sampling over a long period of time to look at what happens to squirrel populations as pine marten numbers increase. So we substituted space for time and sampled in areas where in the Highlands, pine martens have been present for really, really long time, 50, 60 years probably. In central Scotland, I think it was between 10 and 15 years, or and then in the borders, it was less than 5 years. And we found a really strong negative effect with the data that the probability of occupancy for grey squirrels had a very strong negative association as exposure to pine martens increased, and the opposite was true for red squirrels. So as exposure to pine marten increases, so does the likelihood that you are going to find red squirrels at that site. And then in 2019, there was another All-Ireland Squirrel and Pine Marten Survey, now being called the Squirrel and Pine Marten Survey, not just the Squirrel Survey. And we can see a really dramatic decline again in grey squirrels on the left-hand side here. So really holding on in the north and the east. Belfast and Dublin, and red squirrels doing really, really well. Pine marten recovery advancing even further. So that was really, really encouraging to see. Red squirrels are obviously really outcompeting grey squirrels throughout the majority of Ireland now, and this is in the absence of any significant grey squirrel control. In 2020, there were loads of papers published. So Josh Twining published a paper, his first paper of that year, on the different behavioural responses to predator odour. So I'll explain this chart briefly. Basically, unfortunately, I think my head might be obscuring it for you. But what you should be able to see is the black lines are in the chart are red squirrel visits to feeders, and the grey lines are grey squirrel visits to feeders. And that big black line down the middle is the event when the feeders were basically doused with diluted pine marten scat. So you have 3 days before the odour event, dousing the feeders with scat, and then looking with trail cameras beforehand and afterhand, was there a difference in the number of visits to the feeder or in how the squirrels behaved? And for 48 hours, red squirrel visits to feeders really, really, really dropped off, and their behaviour also changed as well. They became more vigilant. Whereas nothing really was observed, I think, at all in grey squirrels, suggesting that grey squirrels are naive to the odour of pine martens, which could be really significant in the ability of pine martens to actually locate and predate on grey squirrels if their prey is naive. So now we have in the Northeast, we have tried to use this to replicate this in an attempt to deter red squirrels from entering our grey squirrel traps, which is a big problem for us because they love to go into the traps. It's hard to keep them out of them. And that obviously impedes our ability to trap grey squirrels when we want to in some locations. Now, we have tried using pine marten scat at the entrance, at the corners of the traps to deter red squirrels from going in, and it has not shown any promise yet. However, it may be down to the fact that we're using the scat quite neatly, and in this study the scat was literally doused all over the feeder. So we're gonna try a few different ways and see if it might help. We're not going to rule it out just yet. And the next study from Josh and his co-authors was a dietary study, so his own dietary studies and reviewing what was available in the literature as well. And you can see here we have the red squirrel occurrence in Northern Ireland and the Republic of Ireland is around 4 to 5% frequency of occurrence in scats. So again, what we'd expect and quite low. And grey squirrels significantly higher than that, between 12 and almost 16% of scats contain grey squirrels. In Scotland, reassuringly, look at the sample size, 2,500 scats and between 0 and 0.6 of a percent had red squirrels remains in them. So again, more evidence that a high number of pine martens does not mean high predation on red squirrels. They do eat them, but just not very often. Occupancy models from Northern Ireland then were published in 2020. And so these showed that there was a high probability of occupancy of grey squirrels only where pine marten were absent, and that the pine marten influence was limited only by lack of available habitat. And then we had another study in 2020 from Kat McNichol, who was working on the translocated pine martens in mid Wales, and she found that the translocated pine martens altered the short-term space use of grey squirrels in the site where the martens were released. They used GPS collars on the squirrels. And then there was a modelling paper from Italy looking at predator-prey eco-epidemic modelling, which suggested that pine martens do destabilise the previous equilibria being grey squirrels outcompeting red squirrels. But complete eradication of grey squirrels is dependent on predation rates and on pine marten carrying capacity. So a similar theme, how well pine martens can suppress grey squirrel populations or how well red squirrels can fare depends on how well pine martens can recover. And then we have, that's that one there. And then we have a 2021 Welsh study on the pine marten effect on squirrels and disease. So these models were looking at three priority regions in Wales, and found that the range expansion of recently translocated and then some additional future translocations would increase pine marten range and density sufficiently over the next few decades to reduce grey squirrel density below the threshold that supports squirrel pox virus. So it suggests there could be eradication of squirrel pox virus from Wales within 40 years. assuming that pine martens continue to recover. And this would provide an ecosystem service, obviously, in terms of disease management. And red squirrels can expand their current range despite some pine marten predation. That's also put into the models that there will be obviously some pine marten predation, and that the majority of whales would be recolonized by red squirrels in 100 years. So obviously taking a really holistic long-term approach to the future of red squirrels there with that study in Wales. And then there's one more study that hopefully will be published this year or early next year, again by Josh Twining and his co-authors, illustrating that native carnivores provide resistance to invasive species using the marten squirrel system as an example there. So very interesting paper. To summarise the findings of the research, exposure to pine martens reverses the typical outcome of competition between red and grey squirrels. Pine martens eat red squirrels sometimes. This does not impact them at population level. Pine martens eat significantly more grey squirrels than red squirrels when they're available as prey. Grey squirrels lack suitable physical and behavioural defences, i.e. they exhibit prey naivety. Red squirrels are really good at recolonising. They can do this best where pine marten densities are high. The notion that pine martens will eat all the red squirrels when they're finished with the greys may be well-meaning. Sometimes it's well-meaning, sometimes it's not. There are other motives there. It's completely unscientific in any case, and there is absolutely no evidence. There is only evidence to the contrary. And red and grey squirrels are different species from different parts of the world. It's not just a different that the case that one is a different color than the other, and yeah, we have no fear at all that all the red squirrels will be eaten once the effect on gray squirrels is complete. So gray squirrels now only have a high probability of occupancy in areas where pine martens are absent or rare. Pine marten's sphere of influence is limited by lack of suitable habitat. So cities and suburbs will be the key habitats for survivals of grey squirrels into the future. And obviously areas where pine martens are unable to recolonise and reach healthy numbers. So we look at pine martens in the rest of mainland Britain. So in England and Wales, there was a population reinforcement to whales in the last 5 or 6 years. There have been a couple with a total of 51 pine martens from the Scottish Highlands by the VWT and partners. And there were 4 captive bred pine martens, I believe, released in North Wales last year. And there may be more translocations in Wales planned. In terms of England, there were up to 40 pine martens from the Scottish Highlands translocated to the Forest of Dean in 2019 by Gloucestershire Wildlife Trust and partners. And then there are more planned. To be honest, I can't keep up with how many are being planned. There's some by Derbyshire Wildlife Trust and partners, I think potentially some in Devon and Somerset, and probably more that I haven't listed here as well. There's also evidence of pine martens in Kielder, in Shropshire, in the New Forest, among others too. And what about the future for pine martens in Scotland? What is Scotland doing for its pine marten population? So clearly, looking at this map, which is one that I made based on the sightings and records of pine martens since records began, really. So the very, very darkest squares are more than 85 years since the first record, and the lightest squares are the first record was less than 5 years at the time of making the map, and obviously where there's no records, there's no blue squares on the map. So I made this about 3 or 4 years ago, so it might be a little bit out of date now. There might be more dots to be filled in or some to change color, but it was accurate at the time of making it not that long ago. And you can see obviously that pine martens are recovering from the north. They're doing it slowly and it takes a long time. There have been some translocations, for example, the one to Galloway Forest, which is after many decades, and they're starting to increase and expand from there now. So nothing happens very quickly. They're a very slow breeding population and their recovery still has a long way to go and is going to take a significant amount of time. There isn't any particular plan in terms of pine martens that I'm aware of. They are exported to under license to England and Wales. In terms of the management of the grey squirrel population and the long-term future of red squirrels, obviously pine marten recovery is intrinsically linked to this. But there's more let's just see what happens approach, I think, more than anything. So a sustainable future for red squirrels. Well, grey squirrel control is going to remain necessary for some time. The areas that have pine marten populations that have fully recovered are the areas where there are no grey squirrels. The areas where grey squirrels are problematic are the areas where pine martens have not recovered yet or are at early stages of their recovery. So grey squirrel control will still remain necessary for some time. There's no question now that the fate of red squirrels in the long term depends on the successful recovery of pine martens and the continued grey squirrel control in the short and medium term. Translocations of pine martens not necessarily needed or anything that would need to come into a long-term recovery plan for pine martens. There's lots of other things that we can do. So we could look at habitat management, looking at increasing continuous cover forestry, connectivity, and denning sites. We can look at providing den boxes in areas where pine martens are moving into, in areas that maybe mightn't have the greatest opportunities for denning by the nature of the habitat there. We can take an adaptive management approach, learning more about the status of pine marten populations locally, and on a landscape scale as they recover, and implementing what we know from that in our strategies for grey squirrel control and red squirrel recovery and resilience. At a local scale, you can look at sorry, I missed there. The education outreach are obviously a huge, huge part of contributing and supporting to pine marten recovery. At a local scale, we could look at whether pine martens are coming into conflict with land managers. Why is that? Can this be mitigated for? And obviously, engaging with stakeholders will be absolutely crucial. Finally, we look at urban pine martens. So they're recovering obviously from the brink of extinction, and the landscape has changed hugely in some areas compared to the last time that they would have been found here. We don't know how they will adapt, if at all, to urban environments or suburban environments. In Europe, the stone or beech marten fills the urban niche. We definitely have no expectations that grey squirrels would impact, pine martens would impact on grey squirrels, should I say, within cities. We wouldn't expect them to reach those kind of densities or impact them in such a different environment. But perhaps pine martens can provide a buffer around cities. For example, this is just 1 year of records from Aberdeen City of pine martens from May 2020 to 2021. Those of you who know Aberdeen will be able to identify the city bypass there. So pretty much everything within that is considered Aberdeen City. So a lot of pine marten detections in the course of our squirrel work there in the South City in Deeside. We regularly detect them in our feeders, often catch them, well, sometimes catch them in traps. And then there's some further north in the more Donside area. We've had some scats from Bainston, from just beside Bannatyne's gym, and Don Terrace and Woodside there as well. Loads in Kirkhill, and actually a lot more in the last few months that won't be on that map in the Park Hill area too. So lots and lots of pine martens in and around Aberdeen City and suburbs. And an example of something that we're doing locally, at a local scale to try and help the pine marten population and to improve resilience for our red squirrels in Aberdeen. You'll see these are two of our Northeast Squirrel Volunteers, and our local FLS, Gareth, putting up pine under license pine marten den boxes in some of the woods around Aberdeen City that we know pine martens use them, but we are trying to improve the likelihood that they might start breeding there as well. So that's a local example of looking into the long term building resilience for our red squirrel populations here in Aberdeen. And that is the end of everything. Sorry, it was such a rush. If you have any questions at all, I'm happy to take them. And if anyone would like a copy of any of the research papers, just email me and the email.